It's an honor to be here, and I appreciate your presence. And actually, someone, when it started to rain, people said, you know, that's why sometimes here we don't walk, or we don't bike, or walk to public transit as much as we should. And then that reminded me when I was working in the Caribbean at the beginning of last year. And then people would tell me there, they said, oh, you know, Gil, we cannot walk because it's too hot. Or bike. And now I live in Canada, so I got on the plane and I went back to Canada. yeah, it's too cold. You know, the weather is always an excuse, more than anything. So 2 weeks ago, I took 35 U.S. city leaders to Copenhagen and Malmo, a little bit to learn about how to create cities for people. And then I said, you know, maybe they say that they are the world's happiest people. So they thought they were gonna be seeing all of these blonde, blue eyes jumping up and down on the streets. And then, you know, they said, what is it that makes him so happy? Thank you. And then, but a lot of it is about creating nice, cozy places where people can enjoy. And someone even wrote a book, The Almost Nearly Perfect People. One of the things they do is they walk, they bike, they take public transit. So I got my 35 American friends and we went over and we visited places. And one of the things that we learned is that they have a saying, there is no such thing as bad weather, it's bad clothing. You put on the right clothes and you move and then you go on. But then, of course, it's also about priorities. When it snows, first they plow the sidewalk. Then they plow the bikeway. Then they plow the street. So we gotta have very clear, from the point of view of vulnerability, who's the most vulnerable? The pedestrian. And then the cyclist, and then the transit user, and then the cars. So we really gotta have that in link. And then everybody goes on, and they walk, and they bike. In the rain, in the sun, it doesn't really matter. You know, like 38 out of 100 trips are done on a bike. If it's raining, the same 38 out of 100. They just dressed for the rain. I know some of you are gonna say, oh, Gil, here in Washington State, we are different. Here, we got nothing in common with Copenhagen or New York or Bogota, so you didn't even have to do the presentation. We are done. I know, here, especially in the county, you are unique. Always remember that you are absolutely unique. Just like everyone else. You are unique. You know, in so many ways, this is not like on the computers, that on the computer we can copy and paste, but rather this is how to adapt and improve. We're gonna see hundreds of images of cities that are bigger, others are smaller, some are wealthier, some are poorer, but everything we can adapt to our situation. Even within the county, you have a lot of municipalities, but each one is different. Each neighborhood is different, each street is different, each school is different. But we can learn and we can adapt. And of course, we're moving. But in many cases, we're not moving fast enough. And then sometimes we say, oh, you know, I might be slow, but I'm ahead of you. This is something that is very important for the county. Is who are you gonna benchmark yourself with? Because actually, one of the biggest barriers that you have to improve is that you are good. So sometimes people are more reluctant to change when things are good. Sometimes it's easier to go from bad to great than from good to great. And who do you benchmark? Because if you want to look at municipalities that are worse than you, you can do a list of 1,000 municipalities. But if you benchmark yourself with communities that are worse than you, eventually you're going to look like those. But if you benchmark with the communities that are the best, and that's what you need to do. I mean, you got such a fantastic Washington University, fantastic people there, and you got the business sector, and you got so much vibrancy. So there is no reason why you should not be as good as the best in the best. So you're gonna say, okay, which has the best walking facilities in the world? A city around our size with similar weather, similar income. Which one has the best public transit? Which one has the best environmental policies? Which one has the best university, the best schools, the best of the best on everything? And those are the ones that you should be benchmarking yourself. I know change is hard, but change is hard everywhere. It's not only here. Change is everywhere. I mean, in Copenhagen. In Copenhagen also the car was taking over in the 60s and 70s. They didn't have any pedestrian streets. When they were going to create a pedestrian street, people said, what? A street for people to walk? They said, we have too many cars. And then they said the weather is horrible because it's hot in the summer, it's cold in the winter, it rains all year round. In Copenhagen, it rains much more than here. But the number one barrier is people said, what a pedestrian street? You know, that's not part of our culture. Pedestrian streets, that's for the Italians. Because the Italians are loud and noisy and they like to be on the streets. They say, but we are Danish and the Danish, we are cold and quiet and we don't go out. Except that now the Danish are more Italian than the Italians. They love the pedestrian streets. In the summer, in the winter, in the rain, in the sun. This is City Hall in Copenhagen. All of a sudden they transform a car invasion to people places. More than 18 of those parking lots have been turned into people places. And now the first pedestrian street is as popular as it was when it opened decades ago. So this is part of it. It's how to make that link. And yeah, some of them have cars. I mean, they have a higher per capita income than any city in the US. So they walk or they bike and they take public transit. It's not because they cannot afford a car. No, it's because they'd rather do something else with their money, or they have a car and they use it at night. They use it on Saturdays and Sundays. But on the weekdays, they walk, they bike, they take public transit. Even in the snow, the old people, the young people, and then they count. I mean, why is it that people in Copenhagen bike? Basically because it's safe, it's fast, and it's convenient. It's not for environmental reasons, even though they're very environmentally friendly. It's safe, fast, and convenient. So we gotta make it here safe, fast, and convenient. At one level, they got four cars, then about 4 inches higher for bikes, and another 4 inches higher for pedestrians. So there is a physical separation. Each one has their own place. And also something nice they do in Copenhagen, for nice public places. When you are doing here, either the transit stations or when you're doing parks or pocket parks or whatever, you know, this skateboard park is nice not only because it has a beautiful tree in the middle of it, but one of the things that really makes it work, you know, is this. It has a nice cozy place for the parents. That is very important. We do a playground and we don't even put a bench for the parents. So then the parents, they go to the playground and they get bored and they get cold and they don't want to take their kids. And the kids say, oh, mom, dad, I want to go to the park. Instead, if you get a nice cozy place, is the dad or the mom saying, hey, kid, let's go to the park. It's about creating places. That's why the stations of in transit are also so important. So we got to start thinking, you know, are places, are sidewalks, are they important? You know, it's not so obvious. I go to many municipalities and I show them these playgrounds and these sidewalks. And what do they tell me? They say, oh, Gil, do you want to go do some fundraising? But I go to the same municipality and I show them a pothole. They go crazy about potholes. They think maybe a car is going to fall on the pothole. Or a giraffe is going to come out of it or something. And then the media plays into it. This is a TV station. They hire this woman. All she does is goes and measures potholes. And she has a section on the TV news twice a week. And the citizens, they get organized to pressure the politicians and the city staff on how to take care of the potholes. And when finally they take care of it, elected officials and city staff and everybody goes to celebrate the potholes. So we gotta start thinking, you know, what if we paid as much attention to the playgrounds and the sidewalks as we pay to the potholes? So when I see all of this on the streets, I started thinking, you know, what is the role of the streets? Why do we pay so much attention to the streets? But let's think for a minute. When we take a look at any of our communities from the air, the biggest public space are the streets, the biggest public space. I mean, about 20 to 30% of our cities are streets. When I say public space, you know, it's the space that belongs to all of us, to all the public. And it's about 70 to 90% of the public space. So, I mean, let's think about it. Here we have a lot of also private sector. Does it make any sense that if this is our biggest asset, our most valuable asset, are we going to use it only to move cars 24/7? So we gotta really rethink. For example, we know walking, cycling, and public transit takes up a lot fewer space. So if this is our most important space, shouldn't be using more walking, cycling, and public transit? I mean, let's think about it. We gotta rechange our thinking. Here there used to be a river going through the middle of Oros. And then about 40 years ago, when people were thinking just efficiency, efficiency, they built a road on top of the river. But 7 years ago, someone said, you know, wasn't there a river going down here? And they brought it out, you know, same store. I mean, just think for a minute, would you like to live in this city or in this one? This is critical. This is very, very important. Because quality of life is critical. I mean, we live in an ever more globalized world. In a globalized world, the best people, they can live anywhere they want to. So every morning, the elected officials and the city leaders and the leaders of the community, in the university, in the business, gotta wake up thinking, how can we retain our best people? How can we attract the best people? I'm not talking about quantity. I mean, the U.S. is so good that if you open the doors for 24 hours, you get another 300 million. I'm talking quality. And by best people, I mean however you want to define best. It can be the best hamburger flipper, the best medical doctor, the best engineer, the best carpenter, the best musician. We need to attract and retain the best people. So we got to decide, are we building streets for cars or streets for people? Because we can do one or we can do the other. I mean, the greater Seattle is gonna grow by 1 million people in the next 20 years. What kind of roads are we gonna do? Do we want our streets to look like car storage? Or streets that actually help create community? Are we building these parking lots that work like a gigantic vacuum that sucks the life out of the city? Or do we force them to put street level activity? And then, I mean, change is hard. And one of the messages, especially to elected officials and city staff, when you go to the community, it's not by consensus. Nothing happens. If you want change, change doesn't happen unanimous. It's not by consensus. If you want to do things by consensus, you have to water down change so much that it's not going to be change any longer. What you have to do is listen honestly and have the discussion around what is the general interest. And the general interest must prevail. Here the mayor says, should we make this pedestrian? There were 93 cars parked. And one of the restaurants said, oh, if my clients don't park in front of the restaurant, I'm gonna go broke. They said, no, but it's not the personal interest. What is the general interest? Let's discuss around the general interest. After listening to everybody, they made it pedestrian. Do you think anyone went broke? 10,000 people buy more food than 93 cars. So this is the idea. So we gotta change our mindset in so many ways. And approach, also listen to the children. The children that have so much baggage, so they tell you what's on their mind. Here we were doing that visioning of a park, but we can do it with a transit station or with any place. We gave the kids digital cameras and then we divided up in groups and we went to the park and they took photos of the things that they liked, the things they didn't like. Then we came back and each group of five started working on a computer, downloading images, and each group had a vision, and then we had all together. I mean, it's great. Work with the children, go to the elementary schools. And people say, oh, great that 8 and 8 is working with children because they are the future. No, we don't work with the children because they are the future. In 20 years, they are gonna be adults. No, it's because if we educate the children very, very well, they go home and they educate their parents. When we're talking about change of mindsets, sometimes the children, they learn really well about recycling. And then they go home and they say, hey, dad, you shouldn't be mixing the plastic bottle with the papers. The children are magnificent. For example, here in another city, in another country, we were asking them, how would you like to draw the community, how would you like it to be when you have your parents' age and you have children of your own age? And they started doing all of these drawings. And look, Edgar, he's only 13. But he wrote, I want few cars and I want more people walking and more people cycling. And then he didn't write, but he drew an area where he said, pedestrians here, then cyclists, then buses, and then cars. He's only 13, but he knows that pedestrians, we walk at around 3 miles an hour. And the cyclists are going at around 12, and the cars are going faster than the buses. He knows that if we mix pedestrians and cyclists, the pedestrian is going to get injured. If we mix cyclists with buses and cars, the cyclist is going to get injured. So each one needs their own separate space. And then he drew some public parks and low buildings with street level activity. I mean, a few months after doing this, I was in South Korea working with the PhD students at the National University. And these are urban PhD of urban planning. And I said, I hope that you are studying very, very hard. Because now the 13-year-olds can summarize urban planning 101 in one drawing. I mean, the reality is that we have communities like this. So some people say, oh, Gil, this is common sense. Maybe that's why common sense, they call it the least common of the senses. Yeah, it's not rocket science. What I'm going to be talking here today is not about rocket science. This is not a technical issue. This is not a financial issue. It's a political issue. That's why every citizen has to get involved about how to create cities for all. So that's why I'm so grateful to have been invited by Community Transit to share this afternoon. And I really like the idea that you have involved so many people, because I think you need to create change, to create great cities. We need to have like a three-legged stool. One of the legs are the elected officials at the municipal level, at the state level, at the federal level, and the ones in between, like the Board of Education and all of this. Another leg is the public sector staff, but not only planners and transportation. We also gotta get involved public health and environment and economic development. And the third leg is the community, the university, and the activists, and the media, and everybody. And the three legs gotta move together. If we have a shared vision, then we're gonna move together. So I thank you on that. I want to be talking about two broad topics. One is sustainable mobility, another one is public spaces. But since I only have 90 minutes and not 90 hours, then I'm gonna focus on a few. Walking, cycling, public transit, streets, and sidewalks. Another time you'll invite me to talk about public places, because public places are so wonderful. I mean, during the World Cup, I was in Chicago and I saw a game, the US playing in Grand Park. Now people go to the public spaces and they do so many great things. And here in Seoul, they were doing some of the same things. And in Bogota, I mean, public places are wonderful. I was in Copenhagen, they were playing, they didn't qualify, but even in the initial phases, and then Germany won. But it's not only for soccer. We go to public places in Spain, 40% unemployment for youth. They're taking over the streets. Where do they go? They go to the public spaces. Same thing in Egypt, or same thing in China. Or when Wall Street occupy Wall Street. And not only for sports or political reasons. Here, 2 million people in Rio. And it wasn't for the World Cup. It was for the Pope. Amazing. Any Brazilians here? By the way, the Brazilians know that this Pope is gonna be a saint. You know why? Because to be a saint, you gotta do a miracle. And what was the miracle? That he got 2 million Brazilians to love one Argentinian. The Brazilians don't like Argentinians too much. But here, 2 million people. It's amazing. I mean, we gotta work on the public spaces, like the children. For children, playing is learning, helps muscle strength, coordination, language, cognitive thinking. I mean, and it's not just doing playgrounds of plastic, but not just regular playgrounds. These are the future engineers at the University of Washington. They're rethinking, they're getting their minds. And then we gotta start thinking, when you invite me to talk about public spaces and parks, I mean, parks, people say, should we have small parks? Or medium size or large. Unfortunately, we can have all of them because they satisfy different needs. In the small neighborhood park, that's where we build community. That's where we meet the parents of our children's friends. That's where we develop a sense of belonging, a solidarity. But we cannot play soccer there, so we need the medium size, but we're not gonna go canoeing, so we need the big ones. We need a city-wide park system. So we gotta do a much better job at promoting parks. And actually, each one of the transit stops in some ways is like a pocket park. I'm on the board of City Parks Alliance, and we're gonna do a park conference in San Francisco, so save the dates. So I'm gonna be talking about what inner city is, and some of the problems, and the solutions, and the benefits, and then how to move from talking to doing. Inner city. What's inner city? Inner cities is a simple concept. It's not really about walking and cycling and parks. Those are the means, not the ends. The end is how can we contribute to create some vibrant cities with healthy communities, where people are gonna be happier enjoying their public spaces. That's the, and when I'm in any city, people always come up to me and say, Gil, is this intersection safe? Can my children walk to school? Can my grandparents walk to take public transit? You don't have to be a PhD in transportation engineering. Three simple steps. Step number one, think of a child around 8 years old that you love, your son or daughter or granddaughter. Or once you have that child in mind, go to step number two, think of an older adult that you also love, your parents, your grandparents, your brothers, your sisters. And once you have the child and the older adult in mind, then go to step number three. Would you send them across that intersection? Would you send them walking to take public transit or cycling to get eggs or milk? If you would, it's because it's safe enough. If you would not, it's because it's not. I mean, what if everything that we did here in the county had to be fantastic for an 8 and an 80-year-old? The streets, the sidewalk, the parks, everything in the public space. I mean, we would end up with great community for everyone from 0 to 100. We gotta stop building cities as if everybody was 30-year-old and athletic. And we gotta build cities for everyone. That is the concept. When I say it's not rocket science and it's about happiness, this video reminds me of happiness. That's happiness. I know that happiness is a concept that is hard to define, almost impossible to measure, but that's a goal in life. And we gotta keep that in mind when we make our decisions. I know that in so many ways, each one of us, we seem to be facing a perfect storm. I mean, we got traffic congestion, we got climate change, we got public health crisis, both physical health and obesity, but also mental depressions, anxiety, and we got an economic crisis. And all of this seems to be at the same time. If that wasn't enough, we got a population growth, and we are living longer. So, I mean, in the US, in the next 40 years, we're gonna grow by 130 million people. 130 million. Here in Washington State, it's gonna grow by 1.2 million. And most of it is around this area. So that means that not only do we have to improve the cities that we have today, but we gotta create great cities for these 1.2 additional million. In the US, we gotta create great cities for 130 additional million. That means we're gonna be building like 50 million homes. What is 50 million homes? The same as all of the homes in Canada, England, Switzerland, and Denmark together. It's huge. But also, the population is leveling off around the world. Around 2050, the population is gonna level off around the world, including the US. So we are living in a fantastic time that we gotta assume the responsibility, because whatever we do or don't do is gonna be there for the next hundreds of years. So hundreds of millions of people in the US and billions of people around the world are gonna live in whatever we do in the next 40 years. And also, we're living longer. I mean, we're living longer. This is something very, very new. The population over 60, it used to be only 6% at the beginning of the century. I mean, it's natural for all of us to talk with people that are older than 65 today. Of the people that have ever lived more than 65, half of them are alive today. Half of them are alive today. This is something totally new. In so many ways, this is the baby boomers, how the baby boomers was growing. I mean, we knew that the baby boomers were coming. We knew it 60 years ago. And we don't have the cities ready, and we say, oh, the tsunami. The other day, they invited me to speak to 3,000 people in Minnesota about the tsunami of the aging population. I said, what tsunami? First, tsunami is negative, and this is not necessarily negative. Second, it's unpredictable. No, this is totally predictable. We know the people that are today in their 50s, in 10 years from now, are going to be in their 60s. And if they're in their 60s, they're going to be in their 70s. I mean, look how the over 65s and over 85 are projected to grow in the U.S. So we really got to rethink. What are people that are in their 60s and 70s doing now? Exactly the same thing they were doing in their 50s. Maybe a little bit less. Maybe they were running marathons. Now they run half marathons. Maybe they were playing five sets of tennis. Now they play three. But they are doing very similar things. They also want to age in place. And that's why also why public transit and walking and cycling is so important, because one of the things that terrifies people that when they're really getting really old is the day that they're going to lose their driver's license. But not because they're in love with the car. No, they're in love with mobility. So we need to provide a way for people to move around. I mean, if we had been born just 200 years ago, the life expectancy in the U.S. was just 39. Many of us would be dead by now. And it wasn't just the U.S. That's here, the life expectancy on the left. The U.S., 200 years ago, there was not one country in the world that had life expectancy above 45. Today, there is not one country that has the life expectancy below 45. It's amazing. Now, in the U.S., we doubled the life expectancy. It's very clear we have learned how to survive. But at the same time, when we see all of these issues, we face a challenge, and we gotta learn how to live. And this session, in many ways, is we gotta rethink how do we live. Because a lot of this has to do with the built environment. A lot of this has to do how do we move around. So why don't we turn a challenge into a great opportunity? Because we need to face this challenge that is very real every day. So this is the missing link. I mean, when people say, oh, but the distances are very long. In the U.S., 48% of the trips are less than 3 miles. I mean, we could replace a lot of those, walking or cycling, if it was safe. And the ones we cannot replace walking and cycling, we can replace them with public transit, because they are the link. I mean, half of the trips could be done within a 20-minute bike ride, and one-third within a walk. I mean, we used to walk or bike to school. And now everybody is being driven to schools. There are some symptoms that things are not going well. Many people drive to the gyms to walk on the treadmills. Others pay a monthly fee. They go to 24-hour gyms, and they pay a monthly fee, like this one. What do they do when they're inside? They go up and down the stairs. They could have gone up and down these stairs for free. Maybe it's because we're not doing the neighborhoods that are nice for walking. The sidewalks are not nice. The crossings are dangerous and so on. So we got to create cities for all people. And that's the idea. How are we going to move? Where are we going to create it? This is not an issue of engineering or finances. It's about people. That's why in addition to transportation and planners, we need psychologists and sociologists and anthropologists. And we need to rethink. How do we want to live? This was Melbourne. It was full of factories 30 years ago. Along the Yarra River, today is a fantastic linear park. So how do we recreate cities? Well, there are some ingredients, like we're going to do a pasta. We boil water, we put on the pasta. If we don't do anything else, it's a spiceless pasta. People don't like spiceless pasta. So we got to get ingredients, and we do a nicer pasta. Right? Same thing happened with the city. The cities have some ingredients. People don't like to live in spiceless cities. People move away. Remember that I said how to attract and retain? Well, spiceless cities don't attract and retain anybody, just the opposite. The number one ingredient has to be pedestrians. Walking is the most important thing in anywhere. Why? Because every single trip begins and ends walking. I don't see any cars in this room. So that means that even the people that drove here walked from the car. We walked to the car, we walked to public transit, we walked to the bicycles, we walked to places. So walking has to be the priority, but has not been the priority. This is how we've been building cities. And the little space for the pedestrians, the cars are encroached. And then, I mean, when we do all of this, I was working in Kuwait a few months ago, and lots of highways, money for streets, nothing for the people walking. I mean, we're telling this woman every day, you are a second or a third class citizen. We need to dignify the pedestrians. By the way, here that we're talking so much about transit, every single transit ride begins and ends by walking. So transit and walking, anybody that is an advocate of transit has to be also an advocate of people walking. Because this is, like people, they get killed and then we say, oh, he was jaywalking. And similar to walking is cycling. I just say cycling is just a more efficient way of walking. If we're going to go half a mile, we walk. But if we're going to go 3 miles, we bike. And it's not just for the men 20 to 40 in spandex. It's everybody. The little kid learn how to balance, or the older adult on his trike. And public transit is the link, because if we're going to go further, then we take public transit. That is so important in so many ways, and we're going to talk about the benefits. And this morning I went on this one, which was great, and here we were buying our ticket so that we would not be taken out. Yeah, because this guy was taking people out of. He was checking. And the driver was quite nice. And this was the nicest thing, a priority. You know, this photo is so much about democracy. Why? Because each one of these cars has one person. Each one of these buses has 80. So if we believe in democracy, the bus should have 80 times the right of space than any one of these cars. So it's about them. Sometimes it doesn't seem normal. You know, 100 years ago, women were not voting. And people thought it was normal. No one was complaining. This also seems that it's normal that the cars with one person take over the streets and make all the traffic congestion, and we have the buses going behind the cars. No, we gotta have dedicated lanes. And then we got out, and these people getting out said thank you to the bus driver, and then they continued. And I loved it. It was a nice, you know, one thing I liked. Here it was a parking lot, I was told. And now it's a vibrant business. Land use and transportation is two sides of the same coin. And then we saw also some of the ones that were making the links. And I thought it was brand new, this BRT system. And they said, no, it's been around 5 years. And then I saw these guys cleaning, and I said, that's why. Maintenance is critical. It's very, very important. And then the missing link here is public space. Public space is kind of the glue that links walking, cycling, and transit. Because if all of a sudden it starts raining or snowing and the sidewalk is not safe, and what do we do? I mean, transit is critical. Here, for example, if we just had a stop, it would be nice. But what if on the stop, in addition, we put a water fountain, and we sell flowers, and we put a machine to sell papers and coffee, and a table where people can sit and play chess, and so we create a great place, a destination. So in addition to being a place to get on the transit, we create placemaking. So it's magic, and then we end up having sustainable mobility. And I'm not saying that this is the end of the car era. I'm just saying that walking, cycling, and transit gotta be best friends. But the way we use the cars is changing very, very rapidly. You know, the young people, 18 through 24, half of them don't even have driver's license. Remember, a few years ago, even people, since they were 12, they were counting the days and the hours and the minutes when they were going to turn 16 to get their driver's license. Now, half of them don't even have a driver's license. In the last 2 years, fewer 18 through 24 purchase cars than any time in the last 40 years. So it's changing fast in so many ways. We also have car sharing, and we have electric cars and hydrogen cars and all of this. So all of this, we gotta rethink how we move around. So the car is not gonna be playing the same role. We are buying a lot of things through the internet, but we don't get them through the internet. How do we get them? UPS, FedEx, all of them are hiring thousands of people on bicycles because they have a truck, it comes to one place, and then 10 people on bicycles, they do the last 2 or 3 miles. And it's happening everywhere. You know, we used to have narrow streets. Sometimes people, when they had narrow streets, they said, oh, you know, here, we're going to put some buses on public transit. They said, you know, it doesn't fit. You know, that was last century thinking. When we had a narrow road and you couldn't fit buses and cars, then you only had cars. This century's thinking is if there's not enough space for buses and cars, then you don't have cars. You have people walking, people are riding bikes, and people taking public transit. It's about rethinking how we live and how to improve those public spaces. And then we were on the highway going to Seattle. Can you imagine? We had these people at 10 miles an hour while the buses are going at 60. So they got to be best friends. But of course, we got to improve things. I was in a community. Thank God you don't get this kind of snow. But anyway, a mayor said, "Mayor Gil, we're going to get everybody on the buses because we bought these new buses." I said, "You think anyone is going to get out of their car when this is what the bus stop looks like? This is a school of 1,500 students, and this is a bus stop for 1,500 students." So then I decided to show that mayor another bus stop. He said, "Gil, why are you showing me this bus stop?" I said, "Maybe this is what the bus stop would look like if the decision makers use the bus service." We need to make walking, cycling, and public transit a better option. It has to be either cheaper or faster or more convenient or safer or all of the above, or else people are not going to switch. That's the only way to make the switch. One of my brothers about 25 years ago told me when I was beginning to work in this, he said, "A developed city is not the one where the poor have cars, but it's the one where the rich use public transit." And that's, we gotta change this. Remember that I showed you the 25 American friends that I took to Copenhagen. One of the things that had the biggest impact was something we didn't plan for that week. We had one night off, and they were gonna go out to dinner somewhere, and they were waiting for everybody to come down. And then I was having dinner with the Minister of the Environment. She's a member of the parliament, like at the Senate, at the national level. And she was coming with her mom. Her mom is a member of the European Parliament. All of a sudden, these two women, at night, they come, each one on their bicycle. So I introduced them to all of them, and they said, they never thought that a member of the European Parliament was going out to dinner at night on a bicycle. So the symbolism of showing that the leaders walk and bike and take public transit is something critical, is something very important. To have the stars, all of a sudden, I was in New Orleans. This is a great idea for the university. The University of New Orleans, you know, when students play sports, they get a ring when they play a varsity. So 2 years ago, the coach of the football team, instead of a ring, he gave a bicycle to each one of the players. And if they wanted a ring, they could buy it themselves. But he wanted to show, so that, you know, same thing like the cars. The cars, all of a sudden, the Ford Mustang, the Ford convertibles, they give a nice Ford convertible to the best looking cheerleader in the top 100 schools in the nation. And they do the same with the quarterback of the football teams. They are leaders of opinion. They are trendsetters. So what if they walk? What if they take public transit? So it's really, really important. I mean, people walk. Let's keep in mind, walking and cycling is not a frivolity. Walking, cycling, and the transit infrastructure is a symbol of the respect that we have for people. If we want to improve walkability here, what do we need to do? We need to lower the speed everywhere. Where people live, it has to be 20 miles an hour or less. On the arterials, we can have higher, but where people live, it has to be 20 miles an hour. And it's not just because 20 is plenty, it sounds nice. No, it's because we save lives. If a car hits you at 20 miles an hour, there is only 5% probability of being killed. If it hits you at 40, it's over 80%. And there are many, many studies that show the same thing. No one disputes this. So if we want to save lives, but not only that has double effect. On the one hand, we eliminate deaths, we can eliminate injuries, but on the other hand, we have the benefits. When you are walking, you're walking your dog, or you're walking with your kids or your spouse. All of the, when the cars are going by at 20 or less, you feel comfortable. When the cars are going at 40 or 50, it's not an enjoyable walk. So we need to lower the speed. I mean, we know how to save lives. It's not that difficult. For example, we were doing roads without median. If the road has a median in the middle, we eliminate 56% of the accidents. Why are we doing any roads without putting a median? That was last century engineering. This century, we got to put a medium in the middle, and then we're going to save accidents. And if we want to improve bikeability, let me show you a few minutes of this video of Amsterdam and Copenhagen. Because these two cities are very much like the county here, in weather, in economic level, in education, in everything. So well, let's take a look at 3 minutes.
At this moment, it's Amsterdam. I'm living here, and my name is Eva. And this street is very special because there are no cars allowed. And And so the children can play here very easily, playing on the streets with their bikes, with the balls, all around. It's very lovely.
So if you come to a city where many people are standing and sitting and relaxing and playing, that's because it's a nice place, because they would not start to do all this if it wasn't comfortable and nice.
People-oriented cities offer public spaces which are friendly to everybody. They give priority to people rather than to automobiles.
The city was always the meeting place of people, the place where you could meet your society, your fellow citizens, and you could move about without paying and without being invited. You can move about and see what's going on and see the girls or the boys or whatever you're looking after. And that's one of the major interests of people, that is other people. And a people-oriented city offers that attraction. The other people.
Copenhagen, capital of Denmark, is an example of a people-oriented city. In the past 40 years, Copenhagen has transformed its public spaces. Step by step, Copenhagen has closed to car traffic its main central streets and vital places at the historical downtown. At the same time, the city has ensured an adequate infrastructure for a widespread use of bicycles.
There's a very good quality about Copenhagen, about a city where you can be if you don't have a car. It's not on the premises of the car, but on the premises of the pedestrians and the bicyclists.
And in Copenhagen, we can see that every year there are more and more people who bicycle to work and also to other things.
Denmark is a country with extremely cold and long winters. Nevertheless, in Copenhagen, one out of every three persons uses a bicycle to go to everyday activities.
Normally, when I get up and I have to go to work or to school, I take my bike and drive to school on my bike. Because that's the easiest way, the cheapest way, and the fastest way. Because the infrastructure is in Copenhagen made for bicycles and have been made that way, have been that way for many years.
And now we have a citywide system, so it's a transport system. It goes from one door to the other throughout the city. You can really bike.
In a country where the average wealth per person is higher than in the United States, many citizens have chosen a bicycle as a means of transportation because they live better that way.
Okay. So many cities are trying to work on this a little bit, and they're doing things hoping that they are right. But unfortunately, here we not only have to do things right, but we need to do the right things. For example, we're in a neighborhood and we're doing streets without sidewalks. Doing it right is maybe doing it faster or cheaper. But if still without sidewalks or bikeways, then we're still not doing it right. So we gotta do things right, but we also gotta do the right things. So it's very, very important. Sometimes it's the nice to have and the must have. It's how I try to divide everything we do around cycling. What are the nice to have? Things that make things nicer for the existing cyclists, the 1 or 2%, but doesn't really get new cyclists to go to 10 or 15%. I mean, in Toronto, where I live, people have very thin skin. So I gotta start, when I show Toronto as an example of cycling, which is pretty bad, I gotta say, oh, I love Toronto. And we have the most multicultural city, and people, the children, they walk in the rain and all of this. But one of the things also that I like about the children is that they have right priorities. They know that TV sucks. But in relation to cycling, what do? We paint lines. painting lines, they don't work anywhere. And we put signage, and then we put bicycle rings and bicycle parking and lockers, and we teach classes, and every year a different map and racks on the buses. You know, it's the painted line no one respects. You know, this is Toronto, but could be anywhere in the world. I mean, why do they do it? Because it's cheap. All you need to do is write a check, so it's very easy. I mean, think of a person that doesn't bike on the streets here because they're afraid of biking on the streets. Would that person start cycling because now we have signs or parking or racks on the buses? No. Only two things that need to be done. One, we need to lower the speed in the neighborhoods, because if it's below 20, we can share cyclists, cars, and everyone. And two, we need to create a network of protected bikeways. A protected bikeway is one that separates physically the pedestrians, the cyclists, the cars, thinking of the daytime or the nighttime, with the rain, with the snow. This was Montreal. Montreal, they only had painted lines. Only men used to bike, mostly young. Now, everybody of all ages. It's something that is, this is Paris. It's wonderful. Look at this. They have created over 150 miles of protected bikeways. This is Mexico City and your next door neighbor, Vancouver, what they're doing. So it's, we need, let's not focus the energy, let's focus on the network. It's something that at 880 we have developed, we created the concept minimum grid. What is the minimum grid? Is that instead of focusing on that, we're having elections in Toronto next month. And traditionally, we have 44 councillors. People used to go to every councillor with a different ask. Oh, we need this bicycle lane, we need this park, we need this local. They say, no, don't ask. Only ask for the minimum grid. So if Toronto needs, let's say, 400 miles of grid, let's say the minimum is 200. So let's do, what is those 200, and let's go to the politicians. Are you running for council? Yes. Are you for or against the minimum grid? Oh, no, I love bicycles. No, I'm not asking you if you love bicycles. Are you for or against the minimum grid? Are you running for mayor? Yes. Are you for or against the minimum grid? Oh, we are going to put bicycle parking. No, I'm not asking about parking. Are you for or against the... So we focus. What is the minimum grid? This is Copenhagen. In the neighborhood, the speed is low, but a grid that connects all origins and destinations. Last week, I was in Vancouver, and this is what the mayor of North Vancouver showed me. He's working on this minimum grid for North Vancouver in the next 3 years. I mean, this is Buenos Aires. I'm going to show you some of it. They did 90 miles in 3 years. I mean, when this is Seville. People in Seville said no one is going to bike here because it's so hot. In the summer, it's over 100 degrees. But no, they didn't bike here because there was no network. They had these little pieces. So when there's isolated pieces, it doesn't work. All of a sudden, you do a network, it clicks, and people start biking. And they went from 0.4% to 6.6, and now they want to go to 15%. And that's Seville. I mean, think of a power grid. You're not going to do a power grid thinking, oh, we're going to do this neighborhood, yes, but not the next one. The next one, who knows, the council or what? No, we need a power grid or a water grid. It has to be citywide, has to connect origins and destinations. I mean, in Calgary, they did one, and it wasn't working, so they told Mayor Nenshi, let's take it out. He said, of course, there are not a lot of cyclists because we don't have a network. So he created a network this year, in this spring, and now he's going to wait 3 years. He said, once we have the network, let's see if it works. And some people were saying, but why are we going to invest in protected bikeways if I don't see the cyclist? And then I started thinking of my friend Mike. He builds bridges. And I said, Mike, when you're going to build a bridge, do you have to justify the bridge by the amount of people that are swimming across the river? No, he goes and builds the bridge. You don't have cyclists because you don't have protected bikeways. And then you don't have protected bikes because you don't have cyclists. I mean, walking and cycling is not a frivolity. Walking and cycling is not a joke. Walking and cycling is the only mode of mobility, of individual mobility for most people. It's the only individual mode of mobility for every child and youth around the world. I mean, the children of Bill Gates, if they're under 16, their only individual mode of mobility is to walk and bike. So walking and cycling safely should be a right. The right to safe mobility. Unless you think that only the people that have the money and the age and the desire to drive a car have a right to individual mobility. And if you take away the word individual, then it's walking, cycling, and public transit should be a right. I mean, but that's why I said it's about democracy and human rights and equality and sustainability. It's not, like I was saying, democratic to have a streetcar or a bus with 80 people going behind a car with one person. We got to create cities for all people, and we're not doing it when 1.2 million people die in traffic accidents, including people in cars, people in buses, in motorcycles, in walking, cycling. 1.2 million, that's more than 100,000 every month die in traffic accidents. Why are we not doing something about it? 270,000 of those are people walking. I mean, imagine that all of a sudden we got these four planes up in the air today, Australia, US, Russia, and they crash and everybody dies. And another four tomorrow, and another four. It's a huge world crisis. Well, that's how many people die in walking on the streets every day, the equivalent of four Air Malaysia planes. In the US in the last 10 years, almost over 47,000 people killed. That's more than 16 times more than the people that die in natural disasters. 16 times more. So we got to do something about it. Over 76,000 last year were hit by cars in the public space. So we got to make this a priority. But let me take you back for a minute of my previous life when I was commissioner in Bogota. It's not because I think Bogota's ideal. Of course it's not. It's decades behind any of the municipalities in the county. But I want to show that it's not about the money. And also I've been doing, now I advise a lot of mayors and councilors and communities. But for example, we build a lot of parks and let me show you some. Here, this is a park in the middle of the city. The Pope came in 1968. A million people went there. And then the people left and nothing happened in 27 years. Why nothing happened? And here, the elected officials and the city staff will probably agree with me, because in the city sometimes we have these people we call civic cadavers. What are these civic cadavers? People that you thought that they were dead, but that when you try to do anything, they resuscitate. Not to support, but to oppose. Oh, you want public transit with a dedicated lane? No, that's not the right of the citizens that have cars. So sometimes it's easier not to do anything new. Sometimes it's easier just do more of the same, but a little bit better. But I also learned something, that the citizens pay us every other week is to get things done, not to find too many excuses why things cannot be done. So everybody who works in the public sector, we gotta become a champion at finding solutions to the problems and not problems to the solutions. And that's why the park was like this for 27 years, and in just three, we turned it, we built a lake. This is where the Pope came in the middle. We built sidewalks and bikeways, and people were places where they could walk and run. Lots of children's playgrounds, wave pools, and activities. I mean, there's so many things we can do when we're in the public sector. It's fascinating about quality of life. It's not about the money. In public places, the uses, the activities. Bikeways. We built 174 miles in 3 years. And went from less than 0.5% to more than 5%, always separating pedestrians and cyclists and creating the grid. In some places, so poor that here you couldn't even imagine in your worst nightmare. Look at the levels of poverty. But look at the quality of sidewalks and bikeways. Why is it so important? Part of it is because it's safer, but part of it is because we need to dignify the pedestrian. We need to dignify the cyclist. And then we started doing this. And also, it's part of being consistent. If we say pedestrians first, and then cyclists, and then cars, well, there was not enough money for all three, so we chose the first two and left the cars for future administrations. And then ciclovia, what is the ciclovia? Like an open street. We say on Sundays, remember, it's our public space. It's 30% of our streets. It's about 80% of our public spaces are streets. So a few hours a week on Sundays, let's open them up to people and close them to cars so people can walk and bike and skate. It's something that is really fantastic. It changes minds. All of a sudden people realize, oh yeah, maybe we can do things differently. It changed minds. Tomorrow I'm going to Guadalajara with the Robert Wood Johnson Foundation, and we're taking 20 leaders to see if they become champions of open streets in the US. The American Planners Association, the American Parks and Recreation, the American Transportation, the Heart and Stroke Foundation, UCLA, University of San Diego, UNC, and so on. This is something that could be great. You don't need to invest in arenas or gymnasiums. We interconnect the whole city. Went just from 8 miles to more than 76 miles. And we interconnected the city, young and poor, young and old, rich and poor, everybody. But not everybody wants to walk or bike. So along the routes, aerobics and Tai Chi and cha-cha-cha. And in a city of 7 million people, we get over 1.3 million every Sunday. 64 days of the year, the 52 Sundays plus all holidays. And then my brother was mayor after I was commissioner. And this is what the Japanese corporation, quote unquote, were telling him. Do a $10 billion elevated highways. This was from the national newspaper. But he said, no. This is what the transportation system used to be. But he said, no, we're going to do a BRT, a bus rapid transit. People thought he was crazy. He said, what? It's like a subway, but above ground at 1/20th of the cost. So in each one of your communities, you got to find your solution. When I said, don't copy and paste, no, adapt and improve. See what's good for you. There was a small program in Curitiba, and then he said, no, we're going to do it about 10 times bigger. And then in 36 months, from idea to moving the first 800,000 people, it was built. It moves, this BRT moves more people than 90% of the subways of the world at 1/20th of the cost. Of course, we gotta get links with walking and cycling. How do the people get to the BRTs? They walk. They bike. So we gotta have places next to every single stop. We gotta have bicycle parking so people can bike from their house, or else we gotta put more feeder buses, and more feeder buses is more expensive. So making the links of walking, cycling, and transit is something that is really, really important. It also, you save so much money when you do LRTs or BRTs that you have money to improve public spaces. Let me show you a few minutes of what some people from New York did on this BRT.
And it was really impressive. We got to take a look at that city's bus rapid transit system, which is called Transmillennio. About 10 years ago, when Enrique Penalosa became mayor, there was a plan on the table to build a network of elevated highways all throughout the city of Bogota. It was incredibly expensive and, you know, multi-billion dollar project. And Penalosa and his administration looked at this project and said, you know, this isn't going to do anything actually to solve our traffic congestion problem. It's going to create huge negative environmental impacts on the city as a whole. So Penalosa decided to scrap that project and instead, for a fraction of the cost, replace it with what I think still today is probably the world's most advanced bus rapid transit system.
Tell us what is Transmillennio? Transmillennio is a bus rapid transit and economical model specially developed to operate in Bogota in the main corridors, with the objective is to give a segregate lane, exclusive lane for big buses in order to the people can move very quickly but with a 10 times less the cost of the traditional mass transit system in the world.
Some people call it surface subway. And you could kind of see why. It's buses on rubber wheels, you know, just like you'd see buses in New York. But what you see they've done is, like, in the middle of these busy multi-lane avenues, almost highways, they've taken away a couple lanes in the middle, and they've built these stations. And next to the stations, you'll see usually two lanes of buses running on either side. You know, you have a lane for local bus traffic and for buses to pull into the station, and you have another lane for the express buses. The buses pull right up to the platform so that the floor of the bus is level with the floor of the station. So it's really easy for wheelchairs and you know, older people and people pushing strollers to get on and off the buses. I got to interview the CEO of the Transmillennio system, and she's someone who was there from the very beginning of the system and kind of worked her way up.
Before Transmillennio. Okay, let's continue on this one. So now I work with LA cities, and one of the things I love about LA cities is that I get to the possibility to come here and work with you and meet you and learn from you. This morning was really enjoyable learning about the BRT system here. Last week I was in Grand Rapids learning about the BRT that they opened up in August 14. Actually, I've been in over 180 different cities. One thing that I learned sometimes is that usually these are not politicians. Why? Because the media and sometimes the citizens, instead of supporting innovative, different projects, they really get on top of them. And so they end up doing more of the same, a little bit better, but more of the same. But like Einstein said, we cannot solve the problems by using the same kind of thinking that we used when we created them. So we got to be bold. We got to do innovative things. 4 weeks ago, I was in Buenos Aires, in Argentina. Buenos Aires is totally broke. The whole country is broke. But nevertheless, in the last 30 months, he is the commissioner of transportation. And Paula is not the director of active transportation or alternative, no, the director of healthy transportation. And look at some of the things they're doing. Their first pedestrians, they didn't have any pedestrian streets. Now they got all of these pedestrian streets all over the downtown. They created over 100 street blocks with where the speed is less than 6 miles per hour. So practically there are pedestrian streets where they allow the cars in the terms of the pedestrians if they need to do deliveries. And they are creating bikeways all over the place. 81 miles in 3 years. 81 miles. And then they started, they didn't focus too much on the technical issues. They focused more on the connectivity, how to create the network. And the mayor himself goes on a bike ride every month to remind the citizens that the bicycles exist. And then they continued doing, they increased bicycle share by over 1,000. They were almost non-existent. They were invisible. They were less than 0.5%. They were 0.3. And now they are 3.1. 12% of the population are biking at least once a week. And from 3.1, they want to go to 10% in the next 4 years. They are building another 90 miles of bikeways. And look, adapting and improving. Paula and Guillermo went to New York, and they looked what they were doing, Amanda Burden and Janet Sarikan were doing in New York. And then they went back to Buenos Aires and look at the things. So we need to learn from everybody. Everybody can learn from everybody and adapt and improve. And they were improving their plazas and their, a lot of these pilot projects that you see on the streets of New York. But it's about doing. It's not just about talking, but how to move from talking to. This is a BRT system. They did a BRT system in 30 months. 38 kilometers, that's a little bit over 20 miles, 22 miles. And they're moving 650,000 people. And for the cyclists in the room, when they had elections last year, the leader of the opposing party said, if I win, I'll get rid of all the bikeways. But don't worry, because he lost really, really bad. So on. In the last 3 years, I've been working with Mayor Young, and he wanted to show citizens, what does a city look like without cars? So he said, let's do one neighborhood, 30 days, zero cars. And last September, we didn't have any car during a full month in a neighborhood. But we did a lot of work with the commissioners and directors, and we went to the community and spoke. But the thing I want to tell you is that every time that I would go to Suwon, I had to pass by Seoul. And in Seoul, there was a small river going through the middle of the city, and they built a five lane, and it got full of cars. So what happens when it gets full of cars? People say, let's do an elevated highway. So that's what they did, and it got full. So what did people say? Let's do now a third floor. But the mayor said, what, a third floor? Instead of doing 8 miles through the middle of Seoul, instead of doing an elevated 7 or 8 years ago, he tore it down. The second floor, the first floor, and he brought out the rear, and he created a linear park. He said, there is no city that has solved the issue of mobility through private car. Let's put public transit, and then he created the linear park. Of course, it wasn't easy. Some of the people were saying, mayor, are you crazy? People are not going to stop for coffee. We're going to go broke. As if people going at 60 miles an hour, we're going to stop for coffee. Now they stop for coffee because now they got only 2 lanes and big sidewalks and the linear park and all of these things. So it's hard to make those connections. He was the head of Hyundai when he actually built the elevated highway. Then he was elected mayor in 2002 when he tore it down, and then he was elected president. So to the politicians, sometimes it really pays off to be bold. I mean, in Paris, yeah. One measure about Paris, it's not easy. 8 years ago in Paris, they didn't even know what a public bicycle was. And then they got all of these public bikes. They got 1,451 stations. But what I want to tell you about Paris is that in 1 year, where do they put the 1,451 stations? On the streets. So in 1 year, the mayor eliminated 5,000 car parking. Oh, can you imagine? Sometimes we're going to take 3 car parking, and it seems like it's the end of the world. And the media and everybody, and he eliminated 5,000. And now this is almost like a transportation system that is doing almost 200,000 rides per day. So it's about this. Why so much emphasis on these topics? Because of the benefits. That's why we need public transit, because of the benefits, because we're gonna have cleaner air. Walking, cycling, and public transit has fewer gas emissions than any other mode. It's gonna improve mobility. By itself, it's also, you know, when people say, oh, everybody here drives a car. No, everyone in Washington State under 16, they don't drive, and many of the older adults also, they are not driving. So even in the wealthiest neighborhood, more than 30% of the people do not drive. So we gotta start thinking, it's gonna contribute to make transit better, to have the links of walking, cycling, and transit. It's gonna make us healthier. Is this what the future looks like? I mean, we're having a huge problem. And this is not about looks, it's about heart attacks and respiratory problems and depression and anxiety and all of these issues. I mean, the obesity rate is at 35%. If we don't do something about it, it's gonna go to 44. And it's getting worse year after year. Look, almost no state was even above 19%. Now, everyone is above 20%. 94, the current. If people, why do I show this? Because the people, when they walk, they bike, the rates of obesity are very low. But also, here on these studies, walking, cycling, and public transit, the rates are very low. People with diabetes, it's increasing. There's a direct correlation. One in three children born in the U.S. since 2000 is going to be diabetic. One in three. It's a huge crisis, and it's like a balance. Part of it is what we eat, and part of it is the calories we burn. I mean, we don't have to run marathons. We just got to do 30 minutes a day. And with 30 minutes a day, we're going to have so much better health. So physical activity is a wonder drug. But another wonder drug is public transit. In Australia, they did a study in Victoria, where is Melbourne. People that take public transit were doing 41 minutes of physical activity a day, compared to only 8 minutes for those that were driving. Why? Because they walked to the public transit, then they got on the bus, then they got off the bus, they walked to work. They did the same thing in the afternoon, they did 41 minutes. In the US, the same study has been done, and again, the people do their 30 minutes a day. So it's something that is important. I know that you're going to say, oh, but here we are healthier than in the rest of the states. Not much healthier. In Washington state is 27%, which is the 36th. So not that good. I mean, you guys got to be the best. And I know that you don't like to be called part of Greater Seattle, but that's the number that I found, 22%. That's still more than one in five with obesity. So we really got to do better. This is also good for economic development. When you take public transit or walk or bike, how much can you carry? Things for 2 or 3 days, so you buy local. When you are on a car, you buy for 2 or 3 weeks, so you go to the big box stores. So everybody that says, let's buy local, take public transit, or you're going to be buying local. It's great. But one thing, so some people in the society say, I don't care about the health, I don't care about the environment, what's in it for me? Well, what's in it for me? I mean, people now, they don't have money for clothing, they don't have money for party, they don't have money for retirement, they don't have money to pay education. So what are they doing with their money? Two-car households in the US, the two-car households are spending between 25 and 30% on mobility. 25 or 30. Can you imagine? Out of the whole household income, half goes to food and shelter. Of the other half, more than half is being spent on mobility. That's one out of every $4 that people make after taxes is going into mobility. I mean, I heard from Bill Ford, the chairman of the Ford Motor Company. He invited me to a think tank, and he said, 50 years from now, historians are going to think we were crazy. We were spending 27, what the number he gave, 27 out of $100 on mobility, on something that we use half an hour in the morning, half an hour in the evening, and that is parked for 23 hours a day. People would be spending only 5% if you took public transit and walked and bike. So there is nothing that the governments can do that can have a higher impact on people than making the conditions through walking, through cycling, to public transit, to the built environment, so that people could downsize from two cars to one, or from one car to none. And it's not only great for the people. I mean, the American Automobile Association says one car is $9,000 per year, including depreciation and insurance and so on. This is numbers from Washington, D.C. They decreased by 15,000 cars, and they had a savings, the people had a saving of $127 million. But this is great for the economy. What happens if all of a sudden you got $8,000 in your pocket every year, not 1 year, year after year after year? You go to the restaurants, you go to the bars, you go to the shops, you save for retirement, you improve your garden, your basement. That money stays in the local economy. So instead of paying for cars being built in China or in Mexico, it's gonna stay in the local economy. It's something that is great. It's about how do we wanna live? So I just wanna end by these elements, five elements on how to move from talking to doing. The first one, we gotta develop a sense of urgency. I mean, if this didn't give us a sense of urgency, what it's going to give us. But look, when we define our cities around cars, what do we get? We get more cars. And then we have to invite our friends to help us cross the street. This isn't far from the reality. The streets are getting wider, and the cars are going faster. And we are living longer, so we're getting older. So this is what we do. These cities have been building highways all the time. They haven't solved mobility. The congestion is worse and worse and worse every year. And other countries that are getting wealthier now, like China and India and so on, are moving in the same direction. This is crazy. I was working in Mumbai and Delhi, and I was telling them, you got this huge traffic congestion, and only 15% of the people have cars, and your economy is doing well. Can you imagine? It's very feasible that you are going to go from 15 to 30. Can you imagine if you got this with 15, what's going to happen when you double the cars? So this is what is happening. I mean, building more roads to solve mobility is like trying to put out a fire using gasoline. It doesn't work. So that's why I said we got to build cities around people, and we're going to have healthier and happier people. And that's where I was saying that quality of life is so important. It's the most important tool to be economic competitive. A second element, we got a political will. Melbourne. So people say cities don't change. No, cities don't change. 30 years ago, Melbourne was horrible. It was the ugly duckling of Australia. No one wanted to go to Melbourne. People would go to Australia and would go to Sydney. Now Melbourne, I mean, even they were making fun of themselves, an empty, useless city center. Now people go to Australia, people go to Melbourne because it's one of the top 5 cities in the world. What are some of the things they did? You can do here now, put public art all over the place, but not art for cars at 60 miles, but cars for people walking at 3 miles. Plant trees. Look at the streets. What do they look like without trees? All of a sudden you put trees and it's good for business, good for health, good for the environment. Everything is linked to everything. Public transit, we gotta invest in public transit so that we get people moving, not in cars, but we get everybody can do other things with the money instead of paying cars. Improving public spaces, they had all of these laneways that were dark and dirty, and now they're magnificent, but not one or two, dozens and dozens of these laneways. But it was the combination of the private sector and public sector. All of a sudden, the public sector said, you have a flower business, why don't you set up one on this laneway? And they said, oh, but it's their laneway. I'll give you the seed money, let's do a partnership. I know you're taking a risk. Instead of doing it in the established place, I'll give you $50,000, the seed money. And then they brought people, this is Rob Adams, who led the project for 20 years, taking this into this, and now they got music and restaurants and flower shops and all kinds of things. And no one wanted to live downtown, and now everybody wants to live downtown. Why? They don't need cars. They got beautiful sidewalks and plazas and activities and uses, and it's vibrant and it's exciting, and they got all of this wonderful street furniture. And now what are they doing in some of the suburbs? They say, okay, we're going to modify 7% of the city, the activity centers, and they're going to put public transit. You know, these people living here, they're like slaves to the car. They cannot walk to anywhere. Where are they going to walk? There is no coffee shop, there is no bookstore, there is nothing. They're a slave to the car. So what are they doing? What is the plan? They are putting bus rapid transit, BRTs, here. All of a sudden, these people that were slave to the car, now they're going to be able to walk to public transit. And remember we said public land use and transportation is two sides of the same coin. So they're saying along the bus rapid transit, you got to change the land use. And then they can increase densities. And some of the people in the neighborhood say, oh, but it's going to be crazy. I don't want a 40-story building. No worries. The buildings cannot be higher than the width of the road. A simple rule. So if it's 40 meters wide, it's 40 meters tall. And so is this kind of roads. Why are you going to fight to increase density here? If you get public transit, it's going to increase to this. So it's going to improve your city so much more. I mean, we can either do the 40-story building, or we can do the 4-story building next to each other, which is so much nicer. And this is the kind of thing. So I mean, we gotta have leadership. And leadership, I don't mean world leaders. Leadership that this friend who's a physical education teacher, she saw that each year fewer kids were walking to school. She asked them, why don't you walk to school? Because they were afraid of the cars. So what did she do? Instead of doing nothing, she said, oh, I'm a physical education teacher. No, the kids went home on holidays, they came back, and she was dressed up as a pilot, and she shut down the parking lot. No one could come in their cars. All of a sudden, at minus 24, and the kids started to walk and to bike. We need hundreds of Anne Fentons in the business, in the community, in the schools, everywhere. Because part of it is infrastructure, but part of it is uses. We need doers. I mean, doers, New York, people said nothing can happen in New York, the mafias and the unions and the politicians and so on. Actually, I thought the only way I could see New York from the streets was to run the marathon, so that's what I did. You don't have to do it because these two great women, Janet Sarikan and Amanda Burden, transformed New York. They went to Copenhagen up and down on a bike. They go back, they say, 9th Avenue, cars on both sides. They told the New York Times, we're going to create safer pedestrians, cyclists, and cars. Not in 30 months, not in 30 weeks, in 30 days. Going from this to this is not a technical issue. It's not a financial issue. It's a political. That's why everybody has to participate. Broadway only had painted lines. Who used the painted lines? The cars and the kamikazes. And Janet started taking space from the cars. Just paint, a little bit of paint and umbrella. Look at some of the crosswalk that they're doing in New York. Paints and umbrella, two-year pilot. So they do a pilot. When it's a pilot, people are more open to change. They say, okay, this woman is crazy, but let her do it. Let's do the 2 years. Look at these crosswalks. Here you have so much better weather, your crosswalk should be 10 times nicer than New York. Summer Streets, which is the Ciclovia, they also did the Ciclovia, not in any street, the most iconic, Park Avenue. I mean, when Janet was doing the first one, the commissioner of parks came and said, Janet, this is the most exciting thing in New York in the last 40 years. Can you imagine the minds of change, the change of mindset when the Department of Transportation is doing the most exciting thing according to Parks and Recreation? That's the thing. Times Square. Times Square was not even a square or anything. Just was a gigantic parking lot. And look what they did. So that's when I said you gotta be bold. If you had told anybody 6 years ago that Times Square was gonna be pedestrian, they would have thought you were crazy. Well, they made it pedestrian. I guess the time is almost over because the chancellor got up. So I'm just going to end by, look at the DOT. Can you imagine the DOT doing Tai Chi and yoga and cha-cha-cha? So I'm just going to, and it's only a lot of these little actions as well. So I just want to end by saying, well, public engagement. We got to engage people, you know. Listen to the children, to the older adults. And focus on uses and activities in the public spaces. So I'm just going to end by this. Let's think outside the box. Let's create cities for all people. It's a wonderful time to create alliances between the public and the private and the NGOs. We got to get on board everybody, the transportation and planning and public health and everybody, all ages, the municipal and the state and the federal. There are some challenges, but more than that, there are great opportunities. This is not a financial issue. It's not a technical issue. It's a political issue. Everybody has to participate. It's an issue for everyone. It won't be easy. It never is. But keep in mind, it's not about walking, cycling, or public transit. It's not about parks, streets, or public spaces. It's about how to create vibrant cities and healthy communities where people are going to be happier. So you got a wonderful opportunity, and I wish you all the very best. Thank you.